Right, so anyone involved in clinical research will know the pain and anger of trying to find patients who are eligible and consent them and deal with all the bureaucracy and nonsense that goes associated with that. And from a participant point of view, right, there might be lots of people who are interested in a trial, who are eligible for a trial, but just totally oblivious, don't know what's going on. So, Crossmatch, the silver bullet to act as a broker to connect these two things, this sort of diagram, and also ethics and funders, but going far enough to not. So from a patient or participant point of view, the idea is that you would either sign up, or maybe we can find some wonderful technological solution to connect to electronic healthcare records in a way that isn't a GDPR nightmare. For populating eligibility criteria, you know, age, we might ask for some minimal information, and then maybe we leave them a sort of incomplete profile that we can give you a curated list of studies that you are eligible for, or may be eligible for. You could then click on those, get more information. Maybe we can invite researchers to be able to create more accessible information beyond the scary patient information sheets and consent forms. They can have little videos giving you a sort of breakdown of the study and what might be involved, what you might need to do. And then you can click that you would like to participate in that, and then they can start a process of screening, interacting with the researchers, finding out if you're eligible or not, so on and so forth. Importantly, you can also try and gauge what the participant is keen to do, like what level of invasiveness, compensation, clinical versus private, or you know, academic versus public, that sort of thing. And also allowing patients to be able to follow up with information, right, like alerts as the study is going on, publications, presentations, any breakthroughs, any patents, whatever else might come of that research, and try to foster that sort of community and news and more engagement with the research. So this is a little UI of how we might imagine the app might look from a patient's point of view. So you see it's asking for more information and then sort of matching them to the study, right? And from research point of view, again, sort of similar problem, being able to like, very easily identify the pool of patients who might be eligible for your study, again, setting your inclusion exclusion criteria, but having live updates of who's being recruited as it's going on. Again, useful for sort of ethics and funding bodies who might like to see that research is moving along at the pace that it's supposed to be moving on, and your demographics are getting a good, nice representative cohort rather than some super lopsided cohort that might bother your research. That's the main thing. This is our mock video from the researcher to the system.
Hello. Thank you so much for your interest in our study. For us, having participants is really important so that we can keep you healthier for longer.
So relatable.
And yeah, this is similar to what I covered, sort of like ethics boards. Often again, if you work in clinical trials, you know that you have to do like regular reporting again to like make sure you're on track. If you're not on track, why aren't you on track? Is your cohort representative of all sorts of things? So giving ethics boards and funders an opportunity to oversee what's going on. And yeah, if I hand over to Mark for more technical side of things.
So we saw the idea of being a broker where we might match on SNOMED code. So we wrote some code to do some of that matching, but mostly this is all about the design work and understanding the processes. And I think that's been a huge value here, but we thought the cross-match process would be multi-phased with diagnostic codes on SNOMED. You could say, well, give us types of neurological disease or you know, types of respiratory disease or this specific type of bronchiectasis and allow users to contribute their information as an opt-in process. And so we'd act as a broker. And so you'd end up with kind of a more interactive experience for users, so you know you are part of research, and it's so often the case patients report that they get involved and then don't hear anything more. So why on earth can't they find research and get updates from the research team about publications and that? And this is all hard work. It's hard work for projects to do. It's hard work for funders to do. It's hard work for sponsors. So the pitch is really, you know, act as that medium to do that. So we would match using that, we'd match using geography, postal codes, using NHS data to work out distances and all that kind of work. And then an electronic consent process, and then a manual screening process as well. So you'd have a multi-level screening where patients would know exactly where they were in the process of getting involved in research. And in the future, you would seek their direct consent and potentially hit NHS databases to identify patients. It starts to become the kind of middleware for research. Thank you very much.
Very good. I have to say, Matthias, you can really rival Ben Goldacre for speaking fast.
5 minutes is not very long.
Can I just ask before you go on, what you're obviously talking about a big platform kind of approach, lots of different elements in it. What did you manage to build this weekend?
So we built a small web server and a SnowMed auto completion.
Great.
And
you.
A team. We
built
a team.
You built a team.
You shouldn't underestimate that because the value of the team and the planning and the board.
Yes.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
What did you learn this weekend?
Yeah.
What did we learn? What did you learn?
I learned how to use mobile app. That's, you know, like some of the prototyping. I'm going to rave on about it. I spent like many hours yesterday just like making it look pretty. So that's what I learned.
And she's a GP.
And I thought I knew the domain well, but actually bringing different disciplines together and, you know, people with different perspectives makes things better.
Yeah.
That's what I learned.
So did you learn anything about how you might arrange the data required to run the service?
Yeah.
But we're not going to share it.
I can tell you all about that later, Mike.
So the thing is, like, again, like, we are where we are now, right? And so we talked a lot about whether we could hook into more authoritative sources of things like diagnosis, clinical history. And absolutely, so we've got some of the technologies, but HL7 is not widely accessible to the platforms in the way it would need to be. And yeah, in the future, absolutely, there's kind of scope to invert the control and ownership of that data. So we spoke a fair bit about, you know, potentially some of the distributed, truly decentralized systems and how that might be a way of allowing querying and connection of patients or potential participants to the requirements of projects.
Yeah. Kerry.
So
this is her world.
I was interested, so there's been a variety of approaches to improve recruitment, and I was just wondering what you thought this offered that they didn't. Sorry, be part of research in England. You've had Health West Wales in Wales, you've had Share in Scotland to create these big groupings of people with that you can go back to. And I just wondered, they're not apps, but they are systems for doing things. So I was just wondering.
Well, why have they not got the traction? I think that's a good question to ask. And I don't know why they haven't got the traction, but it's certainly the case that every single project needs to start from pretty much nothing. So these things are always siloed, and what's really frustrating is actually this process is stepping away from that and saying, well, actually, from a user point of view, it doesn't need to be a single app, because it's the data behind the scenes that really matter, but I need a perspective on my stuff that could be federated. It doesn't need to be a centralized system that's designed around me as an individual, and that means me contributing, and I don't think they start from that position. They start from a different position where I'm here and I'm doing it for me because this is the way the funding model works. And so I think the funding model coming from the research is a problem in a way, in that almost it does need to be that two-sided marketplace thing, and that's interesting. And we did have a discussion, and Simon kicked it off actually, about how you might actually monetize some of that platform thinking, so that actually for, you know, healthy controls being part of research might be an interesting way of bootstrapping the whole thing. So I think it's about where you design stuff from and your perspective.
I think it was helpful that for none of us our current main role is clinical research. Like, a lot of us have done bits of that, but for none of us it's kind of, I'm so engrossed in this problem, we were able to sort of step back and think about the whole
thing. I think it's nice to see different approaches to things. One of the things I was going to add, I think it was treated like I'd thrown it in like a landmine into a discussion about Health West Wales, what was being said in Wales, was I suggested that patients who took part should get to be able to decide what surgical support is in future. Because they've contributed their data, and therefore they should be able to have an equal part in setting priorities. And that went no further. That's an example. So I was just kind of
really interesting.
But it is increasingly a thing, right? Like charities having lay people invited and having decisions on research, so it could be another platform for trying to connect them and being like, if you want to have a say in future studies, like say, we can invite you to get involved in panel discussions or funding rounds.
I'm going to allow one more question for Rachel.
Thank you very much.